you. I know some people are walking in here, so we'll go ahead and get started, but as they walk in, just let them go ahead and take a seat here. So we're going to talk about a pretty interesting topic today, security. I know a couple people here maybe have security roles. Most people are technologists. How many people here are in security or deal with security issues? Okay, yeah, it should be everybody, because pretty much technology has integrated with security, and security is a problem for everybody. It's a problem for you even if you're just at home, right? You have Facebook or whatever it is. So we're really going to talk about today how the world has changed. Right now we're in a spot as defenders where the attackers have outsmarted us, right? They're actually winning the war right now, if you will. Okay, we're going to talk about how they're winning the war, and then we're going to dive into some other things, okay? And then really the whole focus of this is to talk about how to, you guys can go back and go fix this, solve this problem. How do you actually make better decisions around security, okay? So I like to start with this. This is kind of the state we're in. A bank robber goes in, wants to rob a bank, and the teller says, you know, you can just do this as easily online. You know, why do you even got to come into the bank anymore to break in and steal money? You can just use online banking, okay? Past couple of weeks, we've seen Bank of America be down. We've seen Chase be affected. We've seen eBay and PayPal, right? So all the financial institutions that represent what we call the U.S. financial core are starting to be affected by security, okay? This is a pretty serious thing, right? I mean, this is game-changing for most people, right? We see this kind of situation where, oh my gosh, I could be sitting in my office and my company's bank accounts could be stolen. Seems like a relatively, you know, new issue we have to deal with. Or was it? Anybody have an idea what this is? It's a great way to start the morning looking at all kinds of destruction. So this is actually the Siberian pipeline, all right? And the time was June 1982. And we were at war with Russia, the Cold War. And the Russians had a great gas pipeline that they had been building, they'd been growing, to be able to distribute gas across their country. And of course, the US didn't want this to happen. We wanted to infiltrate the Russians in some way, shape, or form. So we did something kind of brand new at the time. We worked with the Canadians, and we introduced some malicious code into the actual systems that ran the gas pipeline. And the Russians went and bought this gas pipeline technology from the Canadians, installed it. A couple months later, big explosion happens. Boom, pipeline's destroyed. So the US government worked with the Canadians to put malicious code to cause an explosion in 1982, all right? This isn't new, guys. What has actually changed is who's affected. Before it was nation states against each other. Right? We're going to talk about this case a little bit later in a little bit more in depth, but now it's about us as individuals too, okay? And so I want you guys to realize one thing, if you take away one thing from this presentation at all, is this. Compromising the user, you, individuals, is always easier than the technology. So there's some great technologies out here, you know, as exhibitors for security. There's some great technologies available for purchase. And I think a lot of times as IT folks, we go to try to find a technology solution. Well, the attackers have realized that if they try to fight you technology to technology, they're going to lose. They don't have as nearly as much money as you have to spend on defenses. They don't have as much money to spend on their offensive tools. So why go after the technology where they can just corrupt you as an individual? Right? And that's how they're winning the war. So we're going to talk about some of the psychology around cyber attacks. And then we're going to link that to the technology. All right? So a little bit of background. This is what you guys have to deal with. This is an example of the technologies and tools in an organization, okay? This actually came from a real company, but look at all this great stuff. You got external services, if you're a larger company, maybe you're outsourcing some things, all the way down the stack to databases. Heck, even your own security tools have issues. Symantec has had multiple vulnerabilities in their antivirus system in the past 2 years. VMware just got their source code leaked. Okay, so the security companies, your infrastructure providers, all these people are having to deal with the exact same security issues you're having to deal with. So you have to deal with all this complexity. You have to solve all these security issues. That's what you're tasked with. It's pretty daunting, right? But we've got some ways to solve that here today. So real quick, who am I? This crazy guy up here talking about security, trying to scare the bejesus out of you in the morning, I guess. Mike Davis, I'm the CEO of Savid Technologies. We're an IT security consulting firm, 100 some odd-ish people across the US. But what I'm known for really is being a speaker. I've spoken at all the major security conferences, but I wrote a lot of the tools that people use in their day-to-day lives as security professionals. I wrote Nmap for Windows, Snort for Windows, if anybody here uses Snort, and many, many other tools. So if you do use any of these tools right now and they don't work, don't ask me anymore because I don't maintain them. So sorry. But I was the original guy who wrote these tools for Windows. So anybody using these on a Windows network, those are from me. What I'm most well known for though is these two books. You guys may have seen these. Hacking Exposed, number one computer security book in the world. I'm one of five authors. But I actually released a book about 2 years ago just on malware, on rootkits. And we're gonna talk about malware a little bit today when we talk about the psychology of attackers and how they're using this technology. But you know, these are the two main books. Now, over the past couple of years, I've been fortunate enough to work with some of the top minds in security in a couple of different capacities. And one of those is with Information Week magazine, largest IT magazine in the world. I get access to their entire subscriber base of 1 million people across the world. So some of the stuff we're going to talk about isn't my ideas or my thoughts. This is actual data we've gotten from security professionals and IT professionals like yourselves across the world. Okay, and they came right from Information Week. So at the end of this presentation, if you're interested in some of the reports that I have, you know, if you go to Information Week's website, they charge you $200 a report. I can just go ahead and give you those reports for free because I referenced some of them here today. All right? So let's dive into the good stuff. I think we've all recognized this is a business now for the bad guys. A couple years ago when I was running the McAfee Special Projects team, which meant I ran the red team at McAfee, we were the team that went in and tried to do all the fun stuff like hacking into companies. We hacked into McAfee itself as our own client. We helped with a bunch of different things. You know, I made the statement, this was about 6 or 7 years ago, that you're going to have an opportunity as a university graduate in third world countries and in the rest of the world to go into one or two career paths. One, you can go work for the security companies. They got a 401k, they got benefits and a good salary. Or you can go work for the bad guys who also have a 401k, benefits and a good salary. All right? And that's really where we're at right now. I mean, this is a true 100% legitimate business. Okay, and here's an example. This is a website from Russia. Translated very simply, it says, you know, it's very simple. We buy these products in Western countries with stolen credit cards. You don't run any risk when buying these products. It's a great business to be in. It's 100% profit margin. They go ahead and buy computers with stolen credit cards. They sell them to you. Whatever they sell them to you for is 100% profit. It's a great business, okay? But this business is changing. And it's changing rapidly because the rest of the world, the FBI, ourselves, have started to catch up to some of their tips and techniques. And we've said, you know what, we're not going to stand up to this. We want to go ahead and raise the bar a little bit. Now, this business has helped generate a lot of money. Okay, there's estimates all over the place, anywhere from a couple $100 million to $500 million. Right? And there's a lot of interesting things happening that are changing in this space that you may not realize. Okay, there's lots of interesting connections, like the owners of Facebook. One of the minority shareholders of Facebook is directly linked to this exact website. Right, kind of interesting that one of the shareholders of Facebook has direct links to crime in Russia. Right? The world is different. Now the attacker's tools, a couple quick things. We're actually going to show you some of these so you can understand the mindset of what these attackers are doing. It costs hundreds of thousands of dollars to buy a security technology nowadays. Sometimes even, you know, to deploy it in a larger enterprise, millions of dollars. For $20, you can get started. And it's great about this is you get a 1-800 number you can call up for support. You need to get updates on the latest exploits to be able to break into the newest computers. That's fine, it's just a live update package. That's an extra $50. All right? You want really sophisticated stuff, maybe it costs $3,000, but relatively to get off the ground, it doesn't cost much. If you really want to have fun, we'll talk about it. You can actually do it for free if you just want to, you know, piss people off. So we'll talk about some of those things. But you can see here that they're being actively sold and automated. They're using the exact same capabilities you're talking about, cloud, virtual instances within the you know, computing cloud, like EC2. Okay, the Russian business network runs an amazing set of data centers that are highly redundant. You can rent servers from them. You can also rent PCs that have been attacked or broken into for your own purposes. So they have their own cloud computing infrastructure as well. All right. And what's amazing is some guys would argue that it's just as reliable as Amazon and those other ones that are out there.